The Discoverers, Chapter 23, Part 2. Columbus's dazzling fame, at least from the American perspective, has blinded us to other achievements of seafaring discovery as great or even greater in that first age of the sea. The immediate effect of Vasco da Gama's voyage were incomparably more fulfilling than those of Columbus. Columbus promised the fabled cities of Japan and India, but he reached only uncertain savage shores. When after decades his enterprise finally paid off, it was in the most unexpected ways. Gama proposed to reach the trading capital of India and to initiate a profitable trade, which he did. He promised to circumnavigate the Asian trade monopolies of the Muslims, of the Levant, and of the merchants of Genoa and Venice, which he did. Columbus took the initiative, promised a gold mine, and only found a wilderness. The initiative for Vasco da Gama's voyage was not his own, but that of his king. Not for qualities of character, but for the magnitude of seafaring achievement, Vasco da Gama must overshadow Columbus. Columbus's first voyage went due westward before a fair wind, 2,600 miles from Gomera in the Canaries to the Bahamas, remained at sea for 36 days. Gama's course, which required subtle navigation, took him in a wide circle nearly all the way across the South Atlantic, then against opposite currents and contrary winds. He made the dangerous decision not to hug the African coast, but to swing around through the mid-Atlantic from the Cape Verde Islands to the Cape of Good Hope, a distance of more than 3,700 miles, before reaching the Bay of St. Helena, just above the present Cape Town, remaining at sea for 93 days. From there, his skill in navigation, in managing his crew, and in dealing with the hostile Muslim rulers in Mozambique, Mombasa, and Malindi, finally took him and his fleet across the Arabian Sea and the Indian Ocean to arrive at Calicut, his intended destination on the southwestern coast of the Indian Peninsula, on May 22, 1498. Until then, there had been no seafaring achievement of equal scope. Unfortunately, Gama, unlike Columbus, did not leave us his own records, but luckily a member of Gama's crew did keep a journal, which offers vivid glimpses of the variety of problems conquered en route. The perils of nature and the sea somehow seemed the least threatening, for the sea in those remote parts was empty of human enemies, and nature did not dissemble. But as he crept up the east coast of Africa, where no European ship had been before, and where there were no useful maps, Gama had to use every device to secure an Arab pilot who would guide him across the vast Arabian Sea. At one place after another, at Mozambique, at Mombasa, the pilot he found or had assigned to him by the local ruler proved ignorant or treacherous. Finally, at Malindi, he secured an Arab pilot able to guide his fleet the 23 days across the Arabian Sea to Calicut. The first greeting to Gama's fleet the morning after arrival at Calicut on the southwestern coast of India, recorded in his crew member's vivid journal, proved that the King of Portugal had acted none too soon. On the following day, these same boats came again alongside when the captain major, Gama, sent one of the convicts to Calicut, and those with whom he went took him to two Moors from Tunis, who could speak Castilian and Genoese. The first greeting that he received was in these words, "May the devil take thee! What brought you hither?" They asked what he sought so far away from home, and he told them that we came in search of Christians and of spices. They said, "Why does not the King of Castile, the King of France, or the Signory of Venice send hither?" He said that the King of Portugal would not consent to their doing so, and they said he did the right thing. After this conversation, they took him to their lodgings and gave him wheaten bread and honey. When he had eaten, he returned to the ships, accompanied by one of the Moors, who was no sooner on board than he said these words, "A lucky venture, a lucky venture. Plenty of rubies, plenty of emeralds. You owe great thanks to God for having brought you to a country holding such riches." We were greatly astonished to hear his talk, for we never expected to hear our language spoken so far away from Portugal. The shrewd Gama spent 3 months in palaver with the king, or Samari, of Calicut. He tried to persuade the local ruler that the Portuguese were mainly in search of the Christian kings said to rule in those parts, not because they sought gold or silver, for this they had such abundance that they need not what was to be found in this country. But the Samari of Calicut was insulted that Gama had not brought him costly presents, and spurned the cheap trading goods that might have served well enough on the Guinea coast. Gama tried to explain that his ships had come merely to make discoveries. The king then asked what it was he had come to discover, stones or men? If he came to discover men, as he said, why had he brought nothing? Gama's fleet left Calicut in late August 1498, greatly rejoicing at our good fortune in having made so great a discovery, having agreed that inasmuch that we had discovered the country we had come in search of, as also spices and precious stones, and it appeared impossible to establish cordial relations with the people, it would be as well to take our departure. After contrary winds, obstruction by the Muslim rulers en route, and the curse of scurvy, which decimated the crew, finally two of Gama's four ships, the square-rigged San Gabriel and the caravel Berrio, made a triumphal entry into Lisbon in mid-September 1499. Of the crew of 170 who went out, only 55 lived to return. Not many heroes of discovery have the good luck themselves to enjoy the fruits of their discovery. Vasco da Gama was one. His voyage, which finally proved a feasible route between west and east, changed the course of both western and eastern history. In February 1502, he set out again from Lisbon, this time with a Portuguese squadron to make Calicut into a Portuguese colony. Arriving off the Malabar coast, when he sighted a large dhow, the Mary, carrying Muslim pilgrims home from Mecca, he demanded all the treasure on board. When the owners were slow to deliver, the result was recorded by one of his crew. "We took a Mecca ship, on board of which were 380 men and many women and children, and we took from it fully 12,000 ducats, and goods worth at least another 10,000. And we burned the ship, and all the people on board with gunpowder, on the first day of October." On October 30th, Gama, now off Calicut, ordered the Samori to surrender, and demanded the expulsion of every Muslim from the city. When the Samori temporized and sent envoys to negotiate peace, Gama replied without ambiguity. He seized a number of traders and fishermen whom he picked up casually in the harbor. He hanged them at once, then cut up their bodies and tossed hands, feet, and heads into a boat, which he sent ashore with a message in Arabic, suggesting that the Samori use these pieces of his people to make himself a curry. When Gama departed for Lisbon with his cargo of treasure, he left behind in Indian waters 5 ships commanded by his mother's brother, the first permanent naval force stationed by Europeans in Asiatic waters. The next sequence of steps to establish an empire in India seemed as obvious as the stages down the West African coast. The first Portuguese viceroy of India, Francisco de Almeida, destroyed the Muslim fleet in 1509. Alfonso de Albuquerque, the next Portuguese governor of India, conquered Ormuz, the gateway to the Persian Gulf, in 1507, made Goa capital of the Portuguese possessions in 1510, took Malacca in 1511, then opened sea trade with Siam, the Moluccas, or Spice Islands, and China. The Portuguese now ruled the Indian Ocean. The consequences reached around the world. Much Italian splendor had been based on the wealth of the East pouring through Venice and Genoa. Now the traffic in Asiatic treasures, spices, drugs, gems, and silks, would no longer come through the Persian Gulf, the Red Sea, and the Levant, but on Portuguese ships around the Cape of Good Hope to Atlantic-facing Europe. The Egyptian sultans had been able to keep the prices of pepper high by keeping the consignments down to about 210 tons per year. So quickly was the effect of the Portuguese sea route felt that by 1503, the price of pepper in Lisbon was only one-fifth of what it was in Venice. The Egyptian-Venetian trade was destroyed. The wealth of Asia, the fabled treasures of the Orient, were flowing west. The New Age of the Sea moved the entrepots of commerce and civilization from the coasts of a finite body, the closed Mediterranean, the sea in the midst of the land, to the shores of the open Atlantic and the boundless world-reaching oceans. And we'll start chapter 24 in the next video. Thanks so much for watching. Please like, subscribe, leave a comment below. I'd love to hear your thoughts on the books. I love you guys. As Tigger says, ta-ta for now.